But God is doing something amongst us. God is doing something within us as a church in Greenford. But I believe what we're experiencing now is just a touch of what God wants to do through us. Because there is much, 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 much more to come.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspired biblical teaching and find out how to apply God's Word to your everyday lives. On the website you can also listen to audio versions of these programs or download them as podcasts.
In 2008, we was involved in Greenford Carnival. And in Greenford Carnival last year, we had a prayer tent. It was called the Prayer Zone. And we spent time in that carnival giving people an opportunity for us to pray for people and for them to be touched by God, for us to pray for them, listen for them from God, and see what God does while we pray for them. And I don't know how many people went through that tent last year, but it was probably 9 or 10, maybe about that. That was the figure for the whole day. Before we even done that event, we spent time praying as a church, as laying down for God to touch the Greenford community. And you may look back to that day thinking, after praying all that time, we didn't actually see much physically go on. And to me, it's not what we see with our eyes, but what God's doing in the background, the things we can't see God doing. So I believe last year was a time when we spent time in that community digging foundations for tomorrow, for today, for the future. In April, that's gone, or March, April time, we had our Easter outreach. And in our Easter outreach, we spent time knocking on 2,000 doors and inviting people to events during the church. Again, we had a tent, a gazebo, in the fun day, which people came to, and people got touched by God that day. But there was a difference that day. It seemed to be much more going on from what we experienced at the carnival. Again, this year, at Greenford Carnival, we've done the same thing. We changed the name slightly, we prayed into it, and we saw over 40 people prayed for during that time. And people got spoken to, in terms of what they're being prayed for. People got touched by God. And there's people here today for the first time from being going through that experience. It's good to see you here. But God is doing something amongst us. God is doing something within us as a church in Greenford. But I believe what we're experiencing now is just a touch of what God wants to do through us. Because there is much, 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 much more to come. And it's great having a place where people can go to be prayed for. But amongst us, there's probably 100 people here. There is 100 odd people here which God wants to release, to set free, to release other people around you. Not in a confined area in Greenford Carnival, but scattered around wherever you are. Because you have something great to celebrate. You have something you've experienced. And that is the living God. And this living God has come to this earth to set us free, that others can be free through us. And I'm not also about speaking about God and telling people how great God is, because I believe God has empowered us as a church, empowered us as his body, to be a people who demonstrates what God can do. Because God can heal today. God can set you free spiritually. He can set you free physically. God has no restrictions. But the key is you people in this room. Because you are going to be his mouthpiece, his body, his words on this earth when you speak into situations. Let's turn to Luke chapter 4. It's verse 1031 in the Bible, the church Bible. And we're looking from verse 14 to verse 30. Now, this is set just some time after Jesus was tempted in the wilderness by Satan. And this is what it says. Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit, and news about him spread through the whole countryside. He taught in their synagogues, and everyone praised him. He went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day he went into the synagogue, as was his custom. And he stood up and to read. The scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to release the oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favour." Then he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant and sat down. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him. And he began by saying to them, "Today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his lips. "Isn't this Joseph's son?" they asked. Jesus said to them, "Surely you will quote this proverb to me, 'Physician, heal yourself. Do you hear in your hometown what we have heard that you did in Capernaum?' I tell you the truth," he continued, "no prophet is accepted in his hometown. I assure you that there was many widows in Israel in Elijah's time, when the skies were shut for 3.5 years and there was severe famine throughout the land. Yet Elijah was not sent to any of them, but to a widow in Zarephath in the region of Zidon. And there were many in Israel with leprosy in the time of Elijah, the prophet. Yet not one of them was cleansed, only Naaman and Syrian. All the people in the synagogue were furious when they heard this. They got up, drove him out of the town, and took him to the brow of the hill in which the town was built, in order to throw him down the cliff. But he walked right through the crowd and went on his way." I just wanted to read that to give you a backdrop, but what I wanted to concentrate on was verses 18 to 19. And if we read Isaiah 61, which is page 748 in your Bibles, 700 years before this time came, Jesus is prophesied about this time. And it says this, very similar: "The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives and release from the darkness for the prisoners, proclaim the year of the Lord's favour." and a day of vengeance of our God to comfort all who mourn and provide those who grieve in Zion, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. They will be called oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for the display of his splendour. And it goes on. But what I want to say was this. That passage starts off, first of all, by saying Jesus is the anointed one. Jesus is the one, the Messiah, who's been set aside to set this world free. But while Jesus was on this earth, he proclaimed a new way. He touched people's lives. He healed people. He rose people from the dead. People were physically and spiritually healed. People were touched by this man. He changed lives around them. But what else did he do? He sent out his 12 disciples to do the same thing. He sent out 72 disciples to do the same thing. And in Mark 16 it says this. You can turn to it. It's 1024 in your Bibles. I don't like saying the numbers out actually, because it makes us lazy in trying to find things. But there you go. It's 1024 in the church Bible, not in your Bible. It'd be different. Right. It says this. Mark 16, 15 to 18. This is Jesus talking to his disciples. He said to them, "Go into all the world and preach the good news to all creation. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whoever does not believe will be condemned. And these signs will accompany those who believe. In my name they will drive out demons. They will speak in new tongues. They will pick up snakes with their hands. And when they drink deadly poisons, it will not hurt them at all. They will place their hands on sick people and they will get well." And this is talking about... Who's that talking about? It's talking about us. It's talking about us, church. So we are that body. We are the body of Christ. So we have something great, something powerful to proclaim amongst us. If we go back to that passage in Luke, it starts off by saying this, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor." And you know, God has called us, those of us who are his children, those of us who are his people, to share good news. And you know, I've got a paper here, and I was trying to find some good news. Now, Joan would like this. At the back of it, it says, "England clinging to Ashes lifeline." So, is it dire? It's not good news, is it?
No.
"Don't panic. You must be joking," it says here. Good news, it's raining today. So there could be a draw. Right, let's carry on. Let's look at what else we've got. Latoya Jackson, "My brother was murdered." Right, okay. "Furious MPs vow we will quit over new expenses blitz." Not much good news in here at all. In fact, it's mainly bad news, isn't it? MOD blew £150 million on wrong trucks. Okay, right. But if you look in the papers, all you find generally is misery. Is absolute misery. There's nothing in here apart from the bad things happening in life. Is there anything about Chelsea Football Club? City still in hunt for John Terry? No way. No way. That's not going to happen. That's not going to happen. Right. You can scramble for a free paper at the end if you want to. Right. The first at the front gets it. Right. Now, let me ask you a question. Where's Warren? Where's my mic gone? There it is there. Right. I've got a question for you. If it is so good to follow Jesus, if it is so good to follow Jesus, what would you say, this is a question for you to answer, what would you say is the reason why it's so good news to follow this person, Jesus? What would you say? You can have your hands up and answer that question if you can. I should have given you a bit of notice, but what would you say?
Hope. He's the one that gives me hope.
Hope. Okay.
He forgave my sins and I'm clean.
You're clean, you've forgiven your sins.
He saves us.
He saves us. Excellent.
He changes your life.
He changes your life. Anything else? Gosh, I need to run a mouth in again.
He's not dead, he's alive.
He's not dead, he's alive.
We have eternal life.
We have eternal life. Anything else at the back here? A few good lists. Yes, one more.
He's able to turn all things around.
He's able to turn all things around.
He's good news, not bad news.
He's not like the cricket. He's good news, not bad news.
When you trust and believe in him, things will go well with you.
Thank you. When you trust and believe in him, things will turn around. Yes.
He gives us unconditional love. No matter what we do, he's always there for us.
So this is all good stuff, isn't it? I'm a bit out of shape, actually. I haven't done much running for at least 3 days. Right, now. Actually, Doug, put your hand up. Doug's a marathon runner as well. We went running together the other day. It was good, wasn't it? Right, now. You've heard all those things about Jesus. When is the last time you've told someone about him? About how good and how great he is. Because I've got a list here, all biblical lists. In Romans 1:17, the good news of Jesus, it reveals God's righteousness to us. In Colossians, there's hope. In Acts, he intervenes in people's lives. You know, there's many people here, but we serve a God who doesn't just care about this whole world, but he cares about you individually. So every one of you, he cares and loves about you, loves you individually. He knows everything about you. And he wants to intervene in your life. In Corinthians, it talks about new birth. Basically, us as people as we are, we fall short of what it is to know God. We fall short. But Jesus is that bridge which gives us access to God, which we'll be going into more in more detail in a minute. Ephesians, there is peace in Jesus. Acts, it says we are released. In Luke, it talks about us being healed. In Romans, it talks about us having faith. In Corinthians, it talks about salvation. We are saved. And there is judgment as well. There are so much good things about knowing Jesus. What are you going to do about this news, which is so good? Because each of you in this room are being strategically placed by God to be with strategic people, for you to touch those individuals in a certain way, which no one else can touch because he's placed you there. And he wants you to talk about the good news like Jesus talked about the good news and demonstrate the good news. Because I believe we're living in a time where this is just normal to God. where he wants to use us in praying for people in our everyday context, for them to be healed, for them to be touched by God, for you to speak into their lives. You've been placed there for a purpose. Let's look at this passage, shall we? Verse 18, it says this: "The Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to preach good news." We spoke a bit about good news to the poor. And, you know, this can be in all these verses, there's a parallel between the physical and the spiritual. And we in this nation are physically rich, but spiritually we're starving. In the third world, these nations are spiritually rich and physically starving. And I want you to imagine this picture. When you see these pictures of when famines go on and people are going through starvation, and these people, all you can see is a spoon. There's no difference to what there is with us spiritually in this nation. They're starving spiritually because they haven't let God in. Now I go into a lot of businesses, and some of these businesses are run by people who've got loads of money. They've got developments where they're spending £11 million on a property to sell it for £20 million. It's very well having the wealth of the world around you, but you can't bring it anywhere with you, can you? But the good news here is this, is that if you're poor physically, if you're poor spiritually, Jesus wants to set you free from that by enriching you spiritually. He's come to feed you spiritually. And the Bible says, if you drink from me, you will never thirst. Last year, when we done the when we had the prayer tent, we had next to us a psychic tent from another place, a spiritualist church, and other things around us. And I believe there's only one way spiritually to go, and that's through Jesus. And what's happening, because we are starving as a nation spiritually, people are looking for the closest fix. The closest fix. What can fix this hunger spiritually? It could be the simplest things, like getting hooked on horoscopes. It could be getting involved in an occult. It could be getting involved in psychic fairs and things like that. But people are searching. That's why it's important for you as the body of Christ to be shouting out, "I know the way. I know the way because I have it. And the way is Jesus Christ. There is no other way to come to God apart from Jesus." And this Jesus will provide for you. If you're in need, he'll provide for you. Physically and spiritually, he'll meet your needs. You know, Wendy and I, we're going through not the bestest time in terms of finances, but one thing that has happened, in this day and age, when you got a job doing specialist work for 4 weeks, it has come out of nowhere. when we needed it. And that's God for you. And time again, I look back when God has met us in terms of our physical situation, where he meets needs. He is concerned about the physical because he says, seek me first and the kingdom of God, and I will meet your needs. Not your wants, not that Ferrari or whatever you want, your needs. Right, he preaches good news to the poor. So if you're poor, you know where to go. And we are poor spiritually, but there is something we know. That hunger, that thirst is quenched through Jesus Christ. It goes on to proclaim freedom to the prisoners. Wayne, is Wayne about somewhere? Can I have you up here for a few minutes, Wayne? Can you just talk to us for a few minutes, what we spoke about a few seconds ago? Now, I haven't experienced anything like Wayne's experience. But one thing I can say is that Jesus has called us to set us free from prison. And when it's talking about prison here, yes, it is talking about possible physical prisons, but because we read about people being set free in the Bible. But it's also talking about here, about the spiritual prison of sin, the spiritual prison of what Satan can do in our lives. But one thing Jesus does for us, and only God can do this, and Jesus is God, he forgives us for our sins that we can be set free. And that gives us access to God if we believe in that. But I just wanted to use Wayne's illustration because prison is very hard for us to comprehend and understand because not many of us in here have experienced that. But Wayne's just going to briefly talk us through what he's been through and how God set him free.
Okay.
Sorry? I've got to turn it on.
We're on. Yes, we are. Yeah, for those who don't know, before I came to Christ and since I came to Christ, I've been to prison. I spent quite a bit of my 20s in prison. I was an armed robber. That was actually my favorite thing to do in life, was to rob people with guns and knives and stuff like that. And I spent a lot of time in prison. When I first went to prison, it was like nothing. When you're in a certain mode of life, certain things happen, and prison happened to be something that just happened if you were in that type of game, if you understand what I mean. Anyway, I got baptized on the 26th of January 2006, and as I've said many times, on the 27th of January 2006, the devil went crazy. He said, yo, this is one of my top soldiers. I'm not letting him go. And he tried everything to make me backslide. And to be honest with you, there were things that he offered me and I didn't refuse. So anyway, consequently, I went to prison since I got baptized, and I'm not condemned for it now, but I shall say I went to prison for assaulting my missus. It wasn't even no big thing, really. You know, I pushed her and she pushed me back and I pushed her back. And, you know, Louise is, you won't believe this, but Louise is really quite loud, you know. You know, like a lioness defending her cubs. Yeah, that type of thing. Anyway, the neighbors called the police. And consequently, I went to court, I got bail and stuff, and I went to prison. I went to prison in Gloucester. They sent me to prison for 3 months. I went to prison all the way in Gloucester, so I couldn't get any visitors. My wife, who had forgiven me by then, thankfully, couldn't visit me. My children couldn't visit me. Nobody visited me. So I was all alone with God for 6 weeks. Six whole weeks. But just to show you how God is so awesome And he said, Wayne, I'm going to show you how awesome I am, even in prison. So I was in prison in Gloucester, didn't know anyone, and I was there for a week. And I don't know, it must have been, well, it was God, I know now. And he let me get a job. The prison warders saw something in me, and I got a job as a cleaner on the wing after only being there a week. That caused a bit of jealousy, but, you know, I can handle myself still. Anyway, I got a job as a cleaner, and, you know, I was earning money, and I was out of my cell all day long. You know, as I say, it caused a bit of jealousy. But then after that, just to even show you how more awesome God is, I got another job, the top job in the prison, which is the gym orderly. And that pays £14 a week. So you can imagine I'm in jail and getting £14 a week, plus my sub, plus my wife, I send me a lick of change. Rich. Believe me. Anyway, yeah. But what I'm trying to say is that God turned my bad situation into a good situation, because I was I got a problem with snoring. Louise would tell you, when I snore, boy, or even the ducks on the canal can hear me. And so I had to have a cell on my own.
I would never know that's a problem.
I know. Yeah, so I was in my cell. When I was in my cell, it was just me and God in the cell. And God spoke to me all the time. He spoke to me through the warders. Because the warders actually put, I don't know why he done this, but he put down a report, because obviously in prison they keep their eyes on you. And I actually glimpsed a report. And the report said that there's something different about this guy, which is me. There's something different about him. I don't have to tell him what to do, where to go, what his duties are. There's just something different. The guy who lived opposite me was a heroin addict. And I just, you know, took pity on him for some reason. And we became quite friendly and thing. And I started to tell him the good news. I started telling him about Jesus, and he said to me, why are you telling me about Jesus and you're here in prison? And I said, because of Jesus. I'm here. He's teaching me a lesson. And I just want to share that with you. And I shared it with him. And I actually met someone who knows Joan Maple in prison. A lady named Linda who worked in the...
Was she in prison as well?
Yeah, she was in prison, but she was doing God's work. She was doing God's work. And we turned friends. Linda. Yeah, she asked me, where do you go to church? I think I started coming here by then. Or
You started.
And I said, Greenford Baptist Church. And she said, nah. I said, yeah. She said, nah. I said, yeah. We've done that for about 5 minutes.
This is Gloucester, isn't it?
Yeah, this is in Gloucester.
This is in Gloucester, everyone. Look how far that is from here.
And she said... yeah, do you know Joan Maple? I said, nah. She said, yeah. I said, nah. Yeah. I said, yeah. And I thought that was amazing. But just the point of it is that I was in prison, but at the same time, God was working through me in the prison.
Thank you. Now, Wendy used to have a problem with snoring as well, because I used to have a big problem, didn't I, Wendy? But it's all gone now. But let me say something else here. Some of you may not be able to relate to that, but that gives you information, because he's been through it. He knows what it's like, and finding God in that situation. But some of you, that prison could be where you are in life. Where you are in life. And wherever you turn, wherever you go, you don't seem to be able to get out of this situation. Jesus is there for you in any situation, to set you free, to lift you up, to carry you, to hold you. That's what he's all about. He's all about giving you life where there was once death. And you know, we talked about prison as in sin being chains around us. But one thing is clear. If we follow Jesus, doesn't matter how bad or how deep you think things have gone wrong in what you've done in your life, nothing can never be forgiven through Jesus. He forgives anything if we come to him. He sets us free. Those chains are taken off and we are alive. We are dead without him, but alive with him. Amen. Right. It carries on. He sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners, we just looked at, and recovery of sight for the blind. Now, there is a spiritual blindness which is hard to explain. But one thing I can say to you is this, is that when you come to know Jesus personally, and when the Holy Spirit comes into our lives, it is like the blinkers of life are taken away from us, and we see things in a different light. That is why it's very hard to evangelize. Because when you're evangelizing and telling people about Jesus, they're seeing it from the other end, the other side. They've got the blinkers on their eyes because they haven't let Jesus into their lives. And there's got to be a point in which the Holy Spirit works in that person's life where they make a leap of faith to help them get unblinkered. And that's your position as God's soldiers, is to be gossipers of the gospel, telling people directions of how to get to Jesus and demonstrating how powerful he is. And you know, one of the greatest stories in the Bible is the story of Paul. On the road to Damascus, we read the story. He meets with Jesus. He's converted. But he is blind. Eventually, he's healed and he can see. But there's a change from position where Paul was. He was blinkered of what is reality to what God wants. He found God and his passion changed for Jesus. Each of us here are here to show people what true sight's all about. And true sight is looking through things through Jesus. Because that's when we get perspective in life. It goes on, released the oppressed. Jesus come here to release the oppressed. And in those days, the Romans, their rule was very oppressive to the Jews. The religious leaders of those times were very, very oppressive to those people as well. The rich, the powerful, fears, doubts. These are all things which come crashing down on us. I was working for a company many years ago, and one of the managers there oppressed the staff so much. This person would bend the rules of work politics to get her own way, in such a way that she made someone redundant in the office, changed a job title, to get her best mate in there to work there. So I said to my work colleagues, this is not right. I'm going to pray about this, and my God's going to turn this situation around. The person she employed, her so-called friend, saw things which she was doing, which was basically out of order. Within 6 weeks, she was gone. The whole regime of that oppression in that company had changed. Her friend took over, and her friend was a fair manager. But God turned that situation around because we asked him to. And whatever you may be going through in terms of being oppressed or people around you, God is able to set those people free. You have keys, church. You have keys for the poor. You have keys for the people who are in prison. You have keys for the blind. You have keys for the oppressed. And you may say to me, but Steve, I talk to people about God all the time, and nothing seems to happen. We talk. Let me say something to you. Whenever you talk about the living God, something is always happening. How old am I? 45 now. It soon goes, isn't it? 29 years ago, I was working for British Gas. And when I was about 17, I became a Christian. And I just didn't care. I just told everyone about Jesus, but it was insensitive. It was like not spirit-led. It was like just Bible bashing. But then eventually, I learned to be a bit more sensitive. When I was about 19, I used to take a person to work with me. They lived in Greenford, and we used to have conversations about Jesus in the car. And they were more arguments, but conversation-y, argument-y type things. And we just had debates. Debates, good word, debate. Also, there was another person at work. I'll call her Viv, I'll call the other one Annette. And she said to me, "You're just going through a phase. This Christianity thing is just a phase you go through. I went through it when I was younger." At Greenford Carnival, I met one particular person, the son of Annette. "How's your mum?" "Oh, she's a Christian now. She's going to church in Harlesden, and she's full on. Can I have your mum's number, please?" So I rang her up. And she screamed. I said, "What was all that 20 years ago? Look where you are now." Vivette is also a Christian as well. Both these people who didn't seem to be going anywhere are saved. Now, I could have been one of 20 people between now and then who spoke to them about Jesus. But I know one thing, I didn't say nothing, but something happened. And what I'm challenging you to do is, though you may not see things happening, believe me, something is happening. Because it's not you, it's the Holy Spirit who's at work, isn't it? But let me challenge you. The Bible says you're there not just to talk about it, but to demonstrate it. So I want you to be thinking about where you're at. Listen to Wayne in prison, sharing his faith with someone. All of you in this room have neighbours. All of you have people you work with. God wants you to engage. So what we experience at Greenford Carnival would be experienced as part of our daily life. And this is not supernatural. This is just natural for God. We talk about a supernatural God. He's not a supernatural God. All these things we hear about are natural for him. And if we are his body, this should be naturally happening through us. Amen? Amen. You have the keys, church, to bring this stage and next further, this next stage further. One of the things I want to ask you, I want you to think about this in your own head, is this. What can you do to proclaim God's kingdom wherever you are? And I believe we've got to be strategic in this, because we could end up speaking to everyone, but what's important is speaking to the people God wants you to speak to. And in a couple of weeks' time, it's holiday season, and I believe God has sent you out on holiday to reach people. Yeah, have a rest, but there could be one person on the plane, there could be one person on the coach, there could be one person on the deck chair next year. You're there for a purpose. Be strategic for God. Be open for God to be used by him. Amen. Right. Where are you today? Where are you today? I know you're in this building, but do you need good news yourself? Do you know Jesus personally? Have you allowed him to come into your life for the first time? Are you physically poor, spiritually poor? Do you feel like you're in a prison and needing setting free? Do you need healing? Do you feel oppressed? Because the answer for all those questions is found in one person, and that is Jesus Christ. Where wherever you're going through, he is there to carry you, see you through it, and help you through it. Now, he's not a magician, as in you call on Jesus and things change overnight. That happens sometimes. Wayne had to go through prison, but he carried him through that time and helped him through that time. And his character was turned and changed during that time as well. The difference is you're not on your own. But we've spoken about how God wants to use us. It says at the beginning of this passage, the Spirit of the Lord is on me. The Spirit of the Lord is on you, because you've been touched by the Spirit of the Lord. He wants to fill you, to empower you, to use you. The question is, are you willing? Are you willing? I believe all the things we've experienced recently is the start of a natural progression of God's power running through us as a church. He wants to touch the streets of Greenford. He wants to touch the homes of Greenford. And he wants to touch the communities you're involved with, because you're there. Let's stand, shall we?
If this is for you, then please come and see me when this time is finished. When we were praying before the service, people were praying for people in bondage this morning. And the image that came to mind was someone coming into church, really tightly bound up, being in church and going home again in completely the same condition. And we prayed about faith being increased. So, coming out of what Steve has said this morning, my appeal is that if you think that's you, if you feel you are in a prison and you're trapped and you are bound up by something and that nothing is changing week in, week out, please come and see me afterwards, because this moment, this morning, the faith is here to have people set free this morning. Thank you. Amen.
Let's pray, shall we? Father God, just pour your spirit upon your body, upon your church now. Fill each person in this room. Equip them. Place people on their mind who you want them to connect with, Father. Set people free who are in bondage, who are poor. Use these people, touch these people, and free them up, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv.